Hello! Welcome back to another episode of
Explosion of Fire!
Yeah, we did it!
We made it to another episode. It's always an achievement, isn't it? I was watching some video and there was this idiot who said, explosives are entirely a human invention. You don't have some pure chemical with a tendency to actually detonate occurring in nature. And I suppose that's mostly true. There's pretty much no mechanism that any primary explosive can be made in nature concentrated to enough an extent to actually detonate. But is it completely true? Let's talk about a plant native to Mexico, Epazote. It's used as a herb in cooking, and its distinctive tastes come from a chemical, ascaridole, which, for some reason, happens to be an organic peroxide. Why does this plant make an organic peroxide? That's a good question. I have no idea. Plants are whack. Right? Plants, man. Don't question the plant. What's strange about an organic peroxide is this oxygen-oxygen peroxide bond is very weak, so this ascaridole could potentially be explosive, and the essential oil from the epazote plant has been reported to have explosive properties. Generally, that's pretty illegal to manufacture explosives. So is this plant committing a crime, or can you make the plant illegal? No, you can't. Imagine making a plant illegal. That's stupid. The plant manufactures the explosive and you just extract it, then technically you're outsourcing the crime to the plant and you're not doing anything wrong. But so is this viable? Can we grow our own primary explosives? How hard could it be? This project starts a little bit over 3 years ago with the purchase of Epazote seedlings online.
The plan is to grow these plants up big and strong.
They grow up really quickly, and within a couple of months, they were ready for their very first harvest.
These plants have been growing for 4.5 months now, and well, quite honestly, they're huge. Look how big they've grown.
So I picked a lot of the seeds and the leaves and ground them all up, ready to do an extraction. You can definitely tell that these plants are full of oil because they've got this very, very distinctive smell to them.
At this point, the smell is like overwhelming. It's a kind of cross between, I'd say, like wet, moldy carpet and chamomile tea.
To this extraction, I synthesized some chloroform and we're using a succinic extractor. Doesn't matter. This works really well to get heaps and heaps of oil out of the leaves, and at first I was really optimistic. It looked like I had so much essential oil that I was ready to message my old high school friends and fellow military wives about this great opportunity that I had. But the problem is the extraction works too well and basically everything gets extracted. The chloroform, all the terpenes, all this other random stuff in the leaves gets extracted, so we get this really strong green solution, which when we evaporate off the chloroform, we're left with just horrible green sludge, and I didn't even film it because I'm an idiot and it just didn't work. We got nothing energetic out of that. It was just green sludge. This didn't really seem like a viable extraction technique, but that's okay. All the hard work is getting done by the plants. So we just wait and the plants will grow back and then we'll try again next year. All of a sudden, disaster struck. Over the course of a couple of months, I just neglected them completely and forgot to water them, and suddenly they died.
That's bloody cooked.
No idea why that is. We'll probably just blame science on that one.
The mysteries of science.
I'm still keen on this project, so I just bought some new plants, and like the cruel, twisted man I am, you know, I just quickly set about neglecting these ones as well.
I should probably put them in the garden this year at some point.
If this project has taught me anything, it's that I'm surprisingly bad at gardening. Anyway, the months started to tick by. The plants did survive. They got really sort of scraggly though, even though multiple people messaged me with suggestions on how I could actually improve them and get them healthier and get more leaves.
I don't think I've achieved very much over this year.
I just didn't do any of that. And I thought, we could just wait another year.
Maybe next year we might have enough leaves to do this project.
I started to get, you know, flashes of my own mortality.
I mean, it's an interesting project. But the thing that I don't like is how much it reminds me of the passing of time.
The months were really just going by, so I thought, screw this, I'm just going to buy some dry epazote online. And for some reason, I bought just a whole lot. It is worth noting that the dried epazote itself has no energetic properties. It doesn't even really burn that well. Before we attempt another extraction, however, let's talk about peroxides and why no one likes them. They've got no redeemable qualities, and they really fall into two categories, the intentional peroxides and the unintentional peroxides. Unintentionally bad peroxides can form because there's quite a lot of oxygen in the air, and oxygen is quite reactive. It can react with a solvent, the classic one being diethyl ether or THF. They will build up over time as the solvent is in storage, so this is a constant issue for lab managers to ensure that peroxidizable solvents aren't left for too long. If you ever ever worried about peroxides in a solvent, it's pretty easy to test. If you've got some iodide salt, sodium or potassium iodide, just add that to some glacial acetic acid. This is a test that makes intuitive sense, because the more yellow the test goes, the more concerned you should be. Yellow equals concern. So for example, if I wanted to test my 1,4 dioxane here that has no stabilizer and has been exposed to air and light for the last 18 months, I would class this deeply concerning levels of peroxide in it. And it would be extremely unwise for me at this point to distill this solvent. This is something that I should probably manage a little better. The other category of peroxides, the intentional peroxides, are even worse though, because these are primary explosives that account for the vast majority of improvised explosive attacks. It is far too easy to make large amounts of these explosives, which you cannot possibly handle because it's too sensitive and too unstable. These class of peroxides really have a reputation as, you know, the worst reputation possible.
All right, that's enough organic peroxides for one lifetime, I guess, really.
But we still gotta answer whether the plant can make us an explosive peroxide. Now that I have so much goddamn epazote, I thought I could try another extraction but using a different solvent. So I was planning to use benzene, but then I checked and all my benzene had evaporated. Instead of trying a solvent extraction now, we're going to try steam distillation. Steam distillation involves just adding the dried epazote to the flask and adding a whole lot of water to it, and we're just going to boil that water. Escaridol is one of the few volatile components of the oil, and while we're not actually boiling out the escaridol because its boiling point is well above the boiling point of water, because it's in small amounts, what happens is it sort of gets carried over with the vapor pressure of the water. In our collection flask, we collect a whole lot of water which has this milky suspension of all the oil from the plant, which is mainly our escaridol. So this solution has a very strong smell to it, kind of halfway between gasoline and fake lime, you know, those lime flavored lollies. It's kind of verging on unpleasant, but it's not like chemically. It kind of smells natural in a sense. Some sort of fake natural cleaning product. Smells are hard, okay? We could do an extraction of this suspension, but I was kind of hoping we'd get enough oil that it would separate out by itself. So I feel like we can do better. I know this kind of feels like an absolute waste, but we've got so much dried epazote to get through that we're hardly throwing the baby out with the bong water here. So we're going to try again, but this time we're going to grind up the epazote. We're going to use my small spice grinder, which only just works after I munted all the blades because I put lumps of vanadium metal in there to grind up.
Don't breathe this.
And then add our water like it's some awful matcha green tea. Matcha. We run the steam distillation and this time we get pretty much the same result. We just get this very strong smelling milky solution that doesn't really separate any oil out by itself. So we have to do an extraction. For some reason I only have a small amount of dichloromethane left. I swear I distilled a whole lot.
The atmosphere is matches
being. When we add the DCM, all the escaridol oil goes into the DCM. We can separate the DCM out. Just do a little bit of work up on it. Wash it with some bicarbonate to remove any acids. Dry the solution out. And then we're slowly evaporating the DCM off to leave us with a small amount of oil. So is this small amount of oil a powerful explosive? Well, no. It sort of just smokes off, filling my lungs with some awful tar. It was horrendous. Whoops. Also, I did break out the rusty axe head to test the impact sensitivity, but it didn't have any impact sensitivity. And also, stop complaining about the rusty axe head, all right? I'm not gonna replace it. I like it, okay? No amount of Patreon money is gonna replace that axe head, all right? If you're joining Patreon because you want me to get a new axe head, it's not happening, okay? Are we asking too much of the scarrow here, expecting some sort of big explosion or primary explosive? Why does Wikipedia say it's an explosive? Really, the source to characterize its explosive properties was this source from 1908. If we read it, it doesn't come across as some sort of wildly impact-sensitive explosive, but really just this molecule that, if rapidly heated, starts to put off a little bit of steam and a little bit of heat. You can imagine this was quite significant for this guy who was producing 300 grams of this oil at one time, but it does ruin the illusion of escaridol as being some sort of powerful explosive. If you take another look at the structure of escaridol, we can kind of understand that it's never going to be a powerful explosive, because that peroxide group is just a bridging group. You're not going to break the escaridol molecule apart by just breaking that one peroxide bond. It's not like other peroxide explosives where once a peroxide bond breaks, the whole molecule ends up fragmenting. All right, let's try it one more time.
All right,
It's time.
Because now we have a technique which we know works. It's steam distillation. We know we get some oil out of it. So let's go back to our fresh plants and pick as many leaves as we can.
Oh, this one's protected. I'm going to leave that one there.
Thank you for your service.
This time during the distillation, we're going to protect it from light as much as possible. So we're going to cover it in tin foil like it's a roommate and we're pulling some prank on it. We're also going to run the steam distillation under a mild vacuum, which allows for the pot temperature to be lower because the water can boil at a lower temperature. So instead of the escaradole potentially decomposing, the water is now only 70 degrees or so and boiling. We're going to get less yield, but potentially our product is going to be less decomposed. So we end up with the same strong smelling solution. We are out of DCM at this point, so I need to go back and get some more out of the pony jar and distill it. We do that, we get our DCM, we extract our escaradole, we do a little bit of work up to clean up the solution, and then we're going to use unrotary evaporation to slowly get rid of all the DCM while still protecting it from the light, which leaves us with a small amount of slightly yellow oil, which we are assuming is our reasonably pure escaradole. Okay, so it's not some wild primary explosive, but it does burn pretty well and pretty clean. So that does tell us that there is some oxygen in the structure. Look, it's something. I'll take it. I'll take the small win after all that work. I'll take it. I think even if we had heaps more oil and we purified it down into really, really pure escaradole using chromatography or one of the numerous techniques that a real lab could use to purify this oil better, I still don't think that escaradole is going to be particularly explosive anyway. The dream is dead, but I still am left with quite a large amount of dried epazote. I suppose there's only one thing left to do with it.
Do we need to consult the big bag of MSG yet?
Do it.
Mmm. That smell it.
Oh god, yeah, sure.
I feel like we need to taste it.
Get that fold. Oh yeah.
Definitely taste it.
Not sure about it. Put it on the spice rack.